Hi, everybody. This is Eric Weisbard, and I'm here today to talk to you about Doggie in the Window for the Pop Conference. Let me see if I can make my crazy technology work. And here we go. So there were two gigantically popular songs about dogs in the 1950s, one of which gets credited with starting rock and roll, Hound Dog, one of which gets attacked in virtually every explanation of the rise of rock and roll ever since. How much is that Doggie in the Window? And that's our subject. Why? And if we undo that disparagement, what are we left with in terms of the questions we might want to ask about popular music? So here we go. Patti Page's How Much Is That Doggie in the Window, a number one hit in 1953, sold millions of copies. It also became a leading example in endless accounts of why rock and roll saved the world from bland pop music. So here's Bob Dylan, for example, looking back on his childhood as a young rebel in an A-bomb threatened Cold War time.
Nobody liked country music or rock and roll or rhythm and blues. That kind of music wasn't what was happening up there.
How much is that doggy in the window?
The music that was popular was How Much Is That Doggy in the Window? That was in our reality. Our reality was bleak to begin with. Our reality was fear. At any moment, this black cloud would explode, everybody would be dead.
Woo! So, a bleak reality, and how much is that Doggie in the Window having nothing to do with it, nothing to do with country, R&B, rock and roll? That kind of attack on How Much Is That Doggie in the Window has taken place throughout the telling of rock and roll history. And yet, I would also point out that a song that has largely been redeemed by that history has had its share of critics as well. Elvis Presley's Hound Dog, a number one hit in 1956, sold even more copies than Doggie in the Window, and seemed to young listeners to confront and overcome some of the fears Bob Dylan is talking about. But as time went on, it became just as frequently cited a case study in problematic pop, an example of white rock and roll stealing black rhythm and blues, maybe most notoriously in the Alice Walker short story 1955, which has a singer modeled on Presley who goes to the black woman who originated the song modeled on Big Mama Thornton and begs her to explain its meaning. I don't have the faintest notion what that song means, Alice Walker has him say. So why did the categories and hits of popular music become so controversial in the 1950s? The long musical answer would require a separate book, but I just want to survey and draw some preliminary conclusions. How Much Is That Doggie in the Window starts with the soft sound of strings and flutes in a tight, quick measure. Then just 5 seconds in, Patti Page sings the chorus. Or Patti Pages do. She's multi-tracked, possible thanks to a very recent technological innovation, magnetic recording. And this adds distance, cool of a kind, and the feeling of produced pop, a movie number that's been reduced to a radio miniature. If we were not already aware of the effects of studio editing, the Doggie in the Window's barks highlight that this is indeed a confection.
How much is that doggie in the window? The one with the waggly tail. How much is that doggie in the window? I do hope that doggie is for sale.
Paige's performance luxuriates, drawing chiffon out from her throat. We're in dance time, waltzing along as she narrates a working, or at least independent, woman's dilemma. I must take a trip to California, but what will become of her poor sweetheart? Notice at this point, a muffled string echoes the puppy barks. You couldn't mistake Doggie for an art song. Each bark, each waggly bit of flute flutter forbids that. But it expresses affluence and power, a nuclear family forming out in the suburbs, perhaps, led by a woman who sounds older than her early 20s. Nobody took Doggie in the Window seriously. Page herself, looking back on her career in 1960, wrote, quote, "We thought of it originally as a cute novelty number," unquote. But it sold 2 million copies the first year, then became a children's record perennial, another expanding segment in a segmenting music industry. And as for Page, despite her mega hits, the former Clara Ann Fowler of Claremore, Oklahoma, never really received much artistic credit. Few novelty performers, especially women, ever did, despite the versatility and acumen required of their role. Hound Dog, by contrast, was hailed as a musical insurrection. The song, written by Jerry Lieber and Mike Stoller, was first sung in 1952 by Big Mama Thornton, with musical accompaniment by an uncredited Johnny Otis and his band for Peacock Records, topping the R&B charts. The Elvis Presley cover version, very different sounding, was released in 1956 and topped the pop, R&B, and country charts all at once, cementing Presley's stardom. All of that goes into founding rock and roll. Lieber and Stoller, to go over well-known material quickly, are white Jewish songwriters, both just 19 and starting out, bonded over their love of black music. Big Mama Thornton is 25, from Alabama, singing in both churches and traveling revues, compared by some for her bluesy growl to Bessie Smith. In Houston, she signs to Peacock Records, one of the few record labels run by an African-American, the ruthless Don Roby. The drummer and band leader on the session, Johnny Otis, born Yanis Alexandros Veliotis to Greek immigrant parents, had essentially switched races, writing, "As a kid, I decided that if our society dictated one had to be black or white, I'd be black." So Hound Dog, commissioned by Roby and Otis to give Thornton her first hit, was a kind of cross-racial appreciation of blackness. Yet gender and class clearly are factors too. Where Page bought a puppy, Thornton in full-on attack mode embodied what academics call female masculinity, as she named her man a no-good dog. As scholar Maureen Mann puts it, she, quote, "flouted the expectations of dominant black and white middle-class arbiters of propriety," unquote, wearing men's clothing on stage, though her private sexuality remains unknown. She wasn't technically the author of Hound Dog, but it was inspired by her act. She told one journalist, "I started to sing the words. I put in some of my own. All that talking and hollering, that's my own." And Mann notices how Thornton bosses her guitarist on the track. "Wag," she tells him. Listening, we're instantly in a different sonic universe than Doggie in the Window, as Thornton's rumbling, phlegmy, and oratorical voice gets the support of what will become a rock rather than jazz trio, electric guitar, bass, and drums. The beat's more slinky than driving, steeped in atmospherics. Thornton supplying howls to go with an instrumental break that lasts more than a third of the song, bodies up to the sound.
You ain't nothing but a hound.
It's musical world-making, studio-edited cabaret, and yes, here too there are some barks at the end. But we're as likely to notice Thornton's shifting vocal accents or the Latin rhythms the Puerto Rican-born bass player has insinuated. As the song rose on the R&B charts in early 1953, the style that Hound Dog represented crossed over to young white listeners. In Cleveland, DJ Alan Freed hosted an R&B program, popular enough that he was hired to New York. In Memphis, Elvis Presley had been listening to the new sounds seemingly his whole life. This was where the first black-oriented radio station, WDIA, debuted in 1948. And by the early 1950s, there were DJs akin to Freed. Dewey Phillips's Red Hot and Blue show on WHBQ, for example. Presley's first single in 1954 for Sam Phillips's Memphis indie label Sun Records covered an older R&B song, Arthur Crudup's That's All Right. A sometime truck driver with sharecropper roots, Presley put out singles, R&B on one side, country on the other, then had his contract purchased by a major record label, RCA, Hound Dog marked the triumph of rock and roll as a new pop genre. But Presley's version sounded a little like Thornton's. In between, Freddie Bell and the Bellboys recorded essentially a parody version for Philadelphia's Teen Records, and Presley heard them perform it in Las Vegas. Here's a little of that.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, hound dog, crying all the time. You never caught a rabbit, so you ain't no friend of mine.
These white Italian Americans were not the only ones making fun of Hound Dog. Sam Phillips' son hired WDIA DJ Rufus Thomas to cut Bearcat. But Thomas's recording, however comic, kept the groove and sonics in place. It was an R&B record, the first of many in Thomas's long career.
You know what you said about me, don't you, woman? Well, you nothing but a bearcat. Been scratching at my door. You ain't nothing but a bearcat. Been scratching at my door. You can purr, pretty kitty, but I ain't gonna rub you no more.
The Bellboys, by contrast, threw horns into the arrangement. They ended the first lines of the chorus with some recorded arf-arfs as a taming device. We can hear more Frank Sinatra in Bell's voice than Big Mama Thornton. He's a Vegas swinger, not a rocker. Still, Presley found something he could work with and incorporated Hound Dog into live shows. And then the response is so dramatic that when he returned for a second time to Milton Berle's television program in 1956, the still unrecorded number spawned a national craze and controversy. Here, Presley fronting a drums, electric guitar, and bass trio, not unlike Big Mama Thornton's, was in motion within seconds. Swivel hips, older jazz fans could date back, but kids considered the most sexual thing they'd been allowed to see. The music, arranged like Bell's version, kept some of the guitar mystery of Thornton's, but there's only the briefest of instrumental breaks. Instead, the sex part continued as the song repeated. And now the camera turned to some white girls watching, stirring. 90 seconds in, the song was done, but then Presley's band slowed into a bump and grind that went on for another thrusting minute.
Well, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, they said you were high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, you ain't never bought a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine. Come on. Yeah, they said you were high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, barking all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, barking all the time. Yeah, you ain't never caught a rabbit. You ain't no friend of mine.
Imagine it going on forever. And in the moment of the performance, it almost seems like it could. But this is such an undefined version of Hound Dog that when it's over and Milton Berle comes out, the old schlocky vaudeville character, he wants to do it as a pure comedy number.
Another one.
breaks his shoe, or at least he pretends to, doing it. Insists on a comedy version, talks with Presley about all the girls flipping their lids for him, mimics those girls as well. All familiar territory from Frank Sinatra days. A starlet comes out to scream on cue. Burl brings up Blue Suede Shoes and Heartbreak Hotel, hits that Presley had performed on his first appearance. Later in the show, Burl has a seven-year-old perform Heartbreak Hotel. Everything is novelty. Everything is youth. Everything is uncoded. I would argue everything is essentially on par with Doggie in the Window. So the question is, how does Hound Dog become the kind of thing Bob Dylan thinks it means? And how does Doggie in the Window become the kind of thing Bob Dylan thinks it means? History hasn't necessarily recorded what Patti Page thought about Hound Dog, or at least I may have more researching to do. But what we know is at least suggestive. She's born Clara Ann Fowler in 1927 in Oklahoma. She's raised in a home that lacks electricity, very much a poor upbringing. Her salvation is show business. As a teenager, she gets a gig singing on radio for the Tulsa station KTUL. The program is sponsored by the Page Milk Company, and on the air, she's referred to as Patti Page. She's actually the second person in the role of Patti Page, but in her case, she keeps the name for the rest of her life. She is literally a milk company's product. Then she's discovered by a saxophone player and band manager, brought around the country to play in his band, ends up in Chicago with Benny Goodman for a moment, and signs to Mercury Records. Mercury is an interesting label in this story, neither a pure major label nor a pure indie label. Guthrie Ramsey and Race Music, for example, makes a big deal of Mercury's ability to live between traditional categories of R&B. I would argue that similarly, Mercury lives within categories of country, pop, and rock and roll. She's the girl singer for Mercury, and her first big hit, the song that really defines her, is Tennessee Waltz. Before there's Doggie in the Window, there's Tennessee Waltz. It too is multi-tracked. It too has Paige's ability to be in and out of a song at the same time. And what's interesting is, in country music terms, Tennessee Waltz is remembered fondly for all the things that in rock and roll terms, Doggie in the Window is hated for. It's a crossover song coming out of country and becoming mainstream pop. But that's not seen as problematic. That's seen as the epitome of country music becoming an industry parallel to rhythm and blues, but a located geographically industry of Nashville, a place where outsiders can become new insiders. And that story, the story of sharecropping family Patti Page, not so different in life terms from sharecropping family Elvis Presley, here, Tennessee, the Tennessee not of Sun Records in Memphis, but the Tennessee of this timeless, ageless, odd locale that the song evokes, that is at the core of helping Nashville become this new branding Music City USA.
I was dancing with my darling to the Tennessee Waltz. What an old friend I happened to see. Introduced her to my loved one, and while they were dancing, my friend stole my sweetheart from me.
So where does this all lead? I'm not going to offer definitive conclusions today. I'm just going to throw out a few thoughts. If we try to reclaim Doggie in the Window, we might start by reclaiming Patti Page as an artist, as the multi-tracking innovator she was, for her ability to take music a step farther than the vernacular, even the electrified vernacular that Elvis represented, and into a sphere that is profoundly sort of futuristic and modern, postmodern and retro, all at the same time. That might be one way to go. A second way might be to look at her story biographically as a story akin to a Dylan story, akin to a Presley story. Part of modern life in the most lived fashion, the arrival of electricity, the arrival of the city in her life, the social upheavals that she writes about in her memoir, seeing losing kids to drugs, having a sense of the society being in profound turmoil, but staying a professional through it, and all the different shifts that that represents. That would be a biographical way of recentering the story. But what I'm most interested in, I think, is how we can look at youth music as a kind of conduit for innovation, an innovation that I don't think we have to judge as revolutionary or counter-revolutionary, but that's profoundly amoral in some sense, driven by money, but in the process, creating a fluidity that's fascinating. A fluidity that allows music to cross between genres, between audiences. From that perspective, we could compare Patti Page to Pat Boone. Pat Boone is seen often in rock and roll histories as another figure to scorn, like the song Doggie in the Window. He covers Little Richard badly. He's seen as a poor substitute, and fortunately Elvis Presley comes along and does it so much better. But Pat Boone and Elvis Presley obviously share a lot in common. They're both white Southern guys signed to indie labels. Yes, Dot Records is less revolutionary than Sun Records, but the comparisons are profound. The covering of black music is similar. The needs are similar. And so then that raises the question of how certain styles of youth music get framed by genre, by ideology, by rock critics. Is this about masculinizing space? Is it about codifying teen culture into the seeds of counterculture? There's a lot of work to be done there, but I think that putting these questions in relationship to music like how much is that doggie in the window will help us get there. What's going to be challenging about it is that we won't necessarily have the help of the artists who are inclined to minimize their own accomplishments in the case of songs like Doggie in the Window or Pat Boone's 10th anniversary with Dot Records. This is, at the end of the day, young music because it hasn't been defined. And to the extent it has been defined, it's by that line in the song, "I do hope that doggie's for sale." Commodification creates youth. The young are new money. That's something to examine, not something to simply scorn. And when we try to go beyond Bob Dylan, try to go beyond Hound Dog, and think about pop music as youthful space of considerable cross currents, Doggie in the Window, by golly, will be waiting for us. Thanks very much, and I hope to do this in person sometime soon.